When the dash and the excitement and the novelty are dead, and you've seen a load of wounded once or twice, or you've watched your old mate dying with the vultures overhead, will you wonder if the war is worth the price?
When Australian medical teams went to South Africa, the compassion they'd learned in hard times was not left behind. They were valued above all others, and they were badly needed. For this was a war where sickness was as lethal as bullets. One Australian nurse watched helplessly as five of her charges died, one after the other.
One was terrible. Quite mad, but often so touchingly gentle and so grateful. "Ah," he used to say, "that's splendid," as I was bandaging his poor face. And the night before he died, he asked me to kiss him.
The New South Wales Army Medical Corps commandeered this building and set up their hospital. They took in everyone, Australian, British, or Boer. Fittingly, it was a doctor who was awarded Australia's first Victoria Cross. Captain Nevil Howse from Orange in New South Wales rode to rescue a trumpeter brought down by enemy fire. Though his horse was shot from under him, he continued on foot, treating the man under fire, then carrying him to safety. We were awarded six Victoria Crosses in South Africa, not for killing the enemy, but for saving others.
They could hear the guns at night, and the Germans flew so low over the trees that we could see them as they were flying over, because they had to go past us to go around to get to the airstrip. One lass said, "Well, if you're taken a prisoner of war," she said, "let your hair down. Make yourself look as ugly as you can, and any of you girls with dentures, take them out." "Make yourselves as plain and ugly as you can." It was all dark excepting for burning ships in the harbour. We had to get over the rails and whatever they had, carrying what you had, what you could have salvaged. And I heard a voice say, "Give me your hand, mate." And I said, "Oh, I'm all right, thank you." And they didn't know, these men didn't know they were getting women. They had no idea. He said, "Struth! Be women!" They were really taken back. But they were marvellous boys. They rescued us and talked and talked and talked all night. They were just so happy to find somebody speaking the same language. Australians to talk to, Australian women, it was wonderful. There was a real camaraderie there, I can tell you.
In Papua and New Guinea, more than 5,500 Australians were killed. 7,000 more lay wounded.
I don't think I ever heard a patient ask for what is now called painkillers. One had to use one's own discretion and powers of observation to know whether a man was in pain or not. But they never complained, there were no yells from them. They were marvellous, really marvellous men. I have nothing but admiration for them. Some of them looked upon you as a big sister. Their big sister. And I know one was asking for his mother, you know, and I just sort of tried to comfort him by saying I was, so that satisfied him. It was before he died. It's not easy, is it? Not easy to forgive and forget. I know one should forgive, maybe not forget, but to do both is difficult.
No matter what battle Australians were engaged in, This aerial lifeline gave even the most severely wounded soldier a chance.
As the war wore on, casualties realised that if they were badly hurt and they could survive till they got to our pad at the hospital, which was known as Vampire for some strange reason, if they made Vampire, they reckoned they had a pretty good chance of surviving. And I think probably that must have had a very good effect on the morale of the soldiers to know that, first of all, they were going to be very rapidly evacuated and then they were going to be dealt with efficiently.
There was one young man flown in with five bullet wounds across his chest. He was in the triage for about an hour before we really thought that he was okay to be operated on. The surgeons put in 48 units of blood in 3 points, and medical people will understand that that's a lot of blood in. It was really coming out as we were putting it in. But he was then in the operating theatre for the next 8 hours. He couldn't go out on the next evacuation to Australia. He was too ill to go. He came to after his 8 hours and, using the good Australian vernacular, spoke to the nurse and said, "Give us a kiss." So we knew there was no brain damage, but we were all a little concerned that he had had some brain damage.
Australia provided a medical team with a small support and protection unit. Their task was to care for UN troops, but they soon found themselves providing critical medical support for devastated civilians.
Sir, he's going to take food. Yes. We won't interfere.
Okay.
If he wants us to do initial treatment, give him some pain relief.
A group of 50 Australians were assigned to Kibeho, where 120,000 refugees were being held by Rwandan soldiers. When the people attempted to escape the camp, they were hacked to death and shot by government troops.
The mood deteriorated further, and whilst we were working on these people, the camp, people within the camp decided to run for their lives. I don't actually know what precipitated it, but they ran through the human barricade of government forces. And I guess the more they try, the better the success is thought. So lots of people ran. They didn't succeed. They were shot, bayoneted, and the government forces chased them down. The landing zone was fairly distant from the treatment area, so we drove down these patients, and we had a great number of them. And I guess us in the distance with our blue helmets on and our blue body armour, we must have attracted attention to the locals stuck within the camp, and they thought they'd try and run again, which they did. And yet again, the government forces shot them down. Whilst they weren't shooting at us, they were shooting at people running at us. There was no constraint at all. So that continued until we evacuated all the people we could, and that was all the patients I had at the time. We returned to the Zambian position and started collecting more patients.
There was also a moment where Carol Vaughan Evans was told that we couldn't go back to get the people who'd been bandaged because the RPA were going to finish them off and a lot of heavy fire had started. And we all looked to her, and she made the decision to go back, which took tremendous courage. It was one of the most courageous acts I've ever seen, because she wasn't just risking her life, she was risking the lives of the people that were working under her. But you could tell that there wasn't even a fraction of a moment where she would have considered not going back for those wounded.
The Australians at Kibeho felt the frustrations of their UN mandate. They could not prevent the massacre and were forced to witness the horror. No one remained unaffected.